Yeah, that's my story. I responded to it radically and immediately, and you know, right from the get-go. But it took two beatings, two self-flagellations along the way, and I've been good ever since. I can sit in a bar full of people drinking, and I don't care one bit, one way or the other.
Welcome, everybody. It's Katie, and I'm here today with a special guest. Today, I have with me Mac. And Mac is a success story of the Sinclair Method. And so just want to start by thanking you so much for joining me today to tell us more about your story of going on this method.
You're welcome.
Yes. Well, you know, it's interesting because usually when I do interviews with people, I have a little bit of their backstory. And with you, I truly don't know much about your journey. So I'm really curious myself to jump into it. Okay. But first, can you just start by telling us a little bit about your drinking before TSM and what kind of led you up to going on the Sinclair Method?
Okay, well, I really started in high school in earnest. And for a long time, it was pretty typical weekend partying, and that went on through a number of years of college as well. It became problematic, I would say, by my late 20s, early 30s in there. Yeah, certainly by late 20s. And I became and was for a long time a binge drinker. It worsened over the years until, of course, prior to this, ultimately ending up in multiple day blackouts. And I put myself in the hospital a couple times in 2020, but mostly prior to that, in the last 5 years or so, it just got worse and worse. Time between them decreasing and so on. Alcohol straight from the bottle, that kind of thing. I mean, I was a pretty heavy, bad blackout drinker.
Wow. So you would go like periods of time with abstinence and then it would like lead into a binge eventually?
Generally, yes. Although oftentimes there'd be light drinking along the way.
Yeah.
I was a professional for sure.
Yeah. Full-time job style, right?
Yeah. Well, it cost me a few of them.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, everything that you know, people talk about happened to me. So.
Wow. Well, I'm really glad that you're here to tell us the story because I'm sure it will reach others. So you said it. What's that?
I said, I just about killed myself.
Wow. Oh my gosh, Mac. Okay. Well, I want to know more about that. So when did you get started on TSM? You said you started drinking really heavily in high school. So that's obviously quite a while. So when did you start TSM?
I pointed out an article in The Atlantic, of all things, that mentioned this to my now ex, still friend, who also does TSM, by the way. I pointed out to her, I watched One Little Pill on January 1st, 2020. so I pointed out to her a while before that. And then she, in the midst of one of my binges, she watched that video and we watched it together New Year's Day, 2020. We watched it together because she wanted me to see it. And that was the beginning, actually. I don't recall if it was that night or the next night, but we both took a naltrexone pill because she'd already had it, not under TSM, but just the traditional and wrong way to use it. So we each took one and drank together, which in and of itself was weird. But and we both ended up having a couple, I don't know, two maybe glasses of wine, and we went to bed. We didn't want anymore. It was like a light switch to me.
Wow. That is so amazing. So is this like just like a year ago? Because we're recording this at the end of 2021. So this was just like last year or 2 years ago?
Beginning of last year. We're sneaking up on 2 years.
Okay, cool. Yeah. Wow.
So what happened with me is we did that, started TSM together, and the effect was profound and immediate. My consumption went down radically. And that carried on, and I moderated. I didn't stop altogether. And what happened is in early March, right when COVID broke out, we went to Guanajuato, Mexico with our son. And she, my wife at the time, was working. I was in Montana. She was working a contract job also in the medical field in California. And so we parted ways. And for reasons passing understanding, on the way home from the airport with my kid to go back home in Montana, I picked up beer and drank without taking the pill. And that set me off on a spectacular rager that required her to come back to Montana. And so then took another swing at the moderation thing, which lasted quite a while. And then we, familial problems resulted in me doing that a second time. You know, I tell people the one golden immutable rule we all well know is you never, ever, 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 ever drink without taking now first. And so I did that twice. I had to be a stupid, you know, I took a little extra teaching.
It happens for people, honestly, and it can be a very valuable learning experience. So I love telling stories like yours, because it just shows that people can come back from that, even though they feel terrible about those types of mistakes or they beat themselves up. Yeah. It's like,
sure. And it isn't like the traditional 12 step. You don't feel like you're starting over. You just pick yourself up and carry on from where you were. There's none of that feeling of, I mean, there's a feeling of failure, but not complete and utter failure. So that happened, and I was pretty good about tracking drinks and all that stuff. So after that second one, which did land me in the hospital, and it was not pretty. After that, I didn't drink for about 10 days at all, because I couldn't. I mean, I was in pretty rough shape. And then I started again, but I bought crappy light Mexican beer, something that I wouldn't particularly like. I was an IPA guy. And started treating it very clinically, which is how I operate. I would drink a beer, and I would do that maybe three or four nights the first week, and then drink a half a beer three or four nights the second week, and so on. And I did that for 4 or 5 weeks, getting down to the point where I was just drinking of a quarter of a beer, just so that my body would, you know, go, oh, hey, booze. Oh, hey, I don't feel it, which is what you want. And sometime around right about a year ago now, I mean, within a couple of days, I did the last one, and I haven't had anything to drink since. I carry the pills with me. I still have I have them in both keychains on both sets of keys, and I still carry them everywhere. And it's the same pills that I put in there a year ago now. I still haven't touched them. I trade with my ex, who still does drink moderately. I trade with her so that I can have fresher ones around. You know what I mean? They don't get too old. Although my current provider out here is on board if I want them. But that's my story. I responded to it radically and immediately and, you know, right from the get-go. But it took two beatings, two self-flagellations along the way. And I've been good ever since. I can sit in a bar full of people drinking and I don't care one bit, one way or the other.
That's so amazing. And the fact that, oh, sorry, I interrupted
you. I was going to say, I cannot understate how big of a miracle it is in my life. Cannot. I mean, I was on the road to a very early grave, and I was absolutely hopeless. And this completely changed it for me. Completely changed it. Saved my life, no question.
That's incredible. And you coming from someone who'd been drinking almost your whole life to a very heavy extent, like sometimes people wonder, is my drinking too bad for this method, or it can't work for people who are severe alcoholics, quote unquote, but you are a perfect case. Like, not only did it work, but you responded extremely quickly, which is pretty amazing.
Yeah. I drank for 35 years, and not all of it was super heavy the whole time. I mean, you know, it ebbs and flows, but the last, I would say, 6-7 years, it was pretty untenable and bad, you know. And ultimately, in part, it did cost me my marriage. Now, I live in Minnesota now. My kid, who you just saw, lives with me. And my ex only lives 2 miles from here. She's from Minneapolis originally. And we are friendly and copacetic, and she gets it. She knows what I went through. She doesn't, you know, you can't help it. No one asks to have this problem. So I'll stop talking. Ask me questions.
No, it's great. I am curious to go back to what you were saying, since you did kind of fall off the compliance wagon twice. Mm-hmm. Is there anything you would share with people that maybe you learned led up to that happening, or something that might help prevent someone else from, you know, going down that path?
I don't know. I mean, the second go around was, again, like family stuff. I mean, you know, emotional things set me off. The first was not like that. And I will say that in my career of drinking, I really never needed a reason. You know, drink as you're happy, drink as you're sad, doesn't matter. I just didn't know what to do other than that, I guess. I mean, I had jobs and career and all this stuff, but the only advice I can give is to absolutely not do it. Or if you're going to, do it very early in the process so you can learn the lesson quick, because it is absolutely gospel true. Do not drink without it, because it's worse. It comes back harder and faster. And I mean, it hit me like a truck. I had no defense whatsoever. I went from a beer to, you know, like vodka bottles under the bed and not going to work and all that, you know, all that terrible stuff, you know, 0 to 1,000 in a second. So the only advice I can give people is do not tempt fate, or do it once early on so you can see what it feels like.
Yeah.
Part of your training.
I've always been curious, and I've never asked anyone this who, you know, stopped complying on the method. Like, what was going through your mind when you were on the bender of non-compliance? Like, were you even thinking about TSM, or was like it just back so strongly that it was like alcohol was front and center?
Everything goes, yeah. Wow. For me, I can't speak to anyone. Oh no, there was no like, oh, I shouldn't be doing this or whatever. Oh no. But when I went off the cliff, I went off the cliff. It was immediate, and everything took a backseat, you know, including my own kid. So, you know, looking back, of course, it's easy to see how horrible it was. But in the moment, I mean, that's why most of the folks watching this, that's why we're here, because everything takes a backseat to it once you get going. The only advice I can give you is don't do it. But this last go around, I think part of it was the bender was so bad and I felt so terrible, and the ramifications around me with job and marriage and everything was so severe that I got kind of a leg up, if you will, on doing it this last time about a year ago. And I really did treat it clinically. I know a lot of the people watching this, if you're on the Facebook group, Hank Reardon gave me a lot of good advice regarding the 30-day future self. I can't recall the man's name off the top of my head. Are you familiar?
Oh, I'm not familiar with 30-day future self.
Benjamin Hardy.
Okay.
Benjamin Hardy, 30-day future self. Google it. It's a 10-minute video every morning. It has nothing to do with drinking and everything about prioritizing yourself and freeing yourself from self-imposed, you know, constraints. Like, I'm only going to be or whatever. No voodoo, no nothing like that. Just very practical things and a little homework every day, and it's free. And so I incorporated that with the motive, you know, that really motivated me above and beyond the TSM itself. And so me being me, I took a very critical, you know, I didn't want to drink most of those beers I did after that last one, or half beers or quarter beers or whatever. I mean, I made myself do it because I wanted my body to feel the alcohol and not feel the buzz.
Yeah.
And I wanted that to happen over and over and over again, and, you know, finish the Pavlovian process.
So you were just having these drinking sessions for the purpose of extinction, really. It's not like you were
for extinction. I bought a 12 pack of Corona Light, and I ended up giving away 5 of them at the end of it. And that was it. I mean, that between my last bender and being done completely were 7 bottles of Corona Light. That's why I say my story is very atypical. Because despite my 2 falls from grace, the effect for me was instant and powerful.
Do you think it was too instant? Because I sometimes hear from people like they don't expect it to work that good, and maybe they're not quite ready to let go of alcohol in the way that TSM causes. What would you say about that?
I would say there's maybe some validity to that, and that may explain the two falls from grace. You know, the first time around, I'll tell you, between that January and March or whatever, you know, I really did want to continue to drink. I wasn't ready to let it go altogether. And I know a lot of people watching this will say that they're looking to moderate. And I think that's fine, you know, whatever works for you, you know. But I don't think I took it all that seriously. I think I saw it as a way to get away with still drinking. I don't know, it's hard to say, but yeah, as far as it working, being so dramatic, the effect, I don't know what to say to that. I didn't expect it, but we, you know, like I said, my ex and I, it was either that night or the night after watching One Little Pill, we did, and we both looked at each other. I was flabbergasted. I'm like, oh my God, I don't want anymore. What is this sorcery, you know? And so I didn't take it too seriously. You know, I mean, the effect was there. Maybe I wasn't ready. Maybe I had to beat myself up a time or two more. And by that last time, you know, a year ago, I was just ready. I'm like, I am so over this. And so I don't miss it at all. You know, I mean, I go out with friends or, my friends, I just moved to a new city. I don't have any, but you know, but I can go.
You will be going out with friends.
Right. I'll be going out with friends. And, you know, it's actually funny. I've been seeing a woman here and I bought her a 6-pack of beer. It'll take her 3 weeks to go through a 6-pack of beer. She's not a big drinker, but that was the first alcohol I bought since I lived in Montana.
Wow.
Yeah. It occurred to me while I was doing it. I'm like, oh, this is weird, but I don't care. I don't think about it. It doesn't bother me. I mean, I can legitimately say, which is, what's the word I'm searching for? Not intuitive. I can't think of the right term, but I'm cured. You know, it's not what you would say. And of course, in 12-step and all that, there is no such thing, et cetera, et cetera. You know, but with the exception of never drinking without the pill, I'm cured. I don't care about it at all. I don't miss it one bit. I never have interest in doing it again. And honestly, outside of doing this interview or whatever, I don't think about it.
That is so cool.
It's beyond miraculous.
Yeah.
Because I've been fighting. I mean, I did the rehab thing. I did all kinds of stuff.
I was just going to ask you, have you tried other things
to quit or come back? Oh, yeah. I've been in and out of the rooms forever, but I'm an atheist. People can believe what they want. I don't care. But I've been an atheist my entire life. And so the whole fake it till you make it thing is just a great big fake it. And it's just a bunch of garbage. Sorry, it really is to me. My brother, interestingly enough, been sober 9 years, also pretty atheistic, but he just found his whatever, a way to work that out in his head. And he does AA, goes to a meeting a week, has forever, and it works great for him. So I wouldn't dissuade, I would never recommend someone who has found success that way to swap to something else. I mean, if you found your jam, do your jam. But it never worked for me. And I went to rehab and just a bunch of crap. Willpower, you name it. This worked. I broke the, you know, the synapses in my brain. That's all it is rewiring your brain. So.
Yeah. It's amazing to be at that place of extinction. It's like you couldn't, at least for me, it's like it was inconceivable when I was drinking. It was like, what do you mean I'm not going to want to drink? Like, I always want to drink.
Right. Yeah. I mean, you can't even imagine it. And now I'm on the other side of it. And I'm like, why would I want to do that? I like getting up in the morning, you know. Just in the last year, my career has changed pretty radically for the better. And that's because I show up and it isn't 2:30 in the afternoon and I'm already thinking about drinking, because that was pretty much what happened every single day. You know, I would look for, you know, I'd scoot as soon as I could to go drink. And now I don't think about it that at all. Yeah.
So can you describe a little bit more of like your day in the life before TSM compared to what it looks like today?
Yeah, well, being in the midst of a binge, notwithstanding, because I couldn't tell you what a day like that was because I don't remember much of it. But oftentimes wake up in the morning feeling fairly rotten and saying, you know, telling myself I'm not going to drink today, and you go to work or not, or whatever it is I was doing. And then at some point, generally around 1 or 2 in the afternoon, the switch would go in my head from I'm not going to drink to I'm going to drink. It's cool. It'll be okay. I mean, it really is like a switch. And it would depend if I needed to hide it from my wife or if I was on my own and could just drink whatever, whenever. I drank at home sometimes. Benders were often at home, but I like to go to anonymous bars. That was my thing. And eventually over the years, it traded from beer to mixed drinks. It was easier, faster, you know. And then go to bed and do it all over again and not get stuff done around the house, underperform at work, you name it. You know, everything was clouded by that. And of course, your thinking is cloudy because if you're drunk multiple days in a row, eventually, or drinking, not necessarily even drunk, but, you know, it makes you fuzzy. It makes you stupid eventually, even if you aren't drunk in the moment. So, you know, it's been a year now, and of course, a lot has changed. But I think I still have some memory issue from it. Not that it's hurting me career-wise or anything, but I think there is some, probably. 35 years got to do something to me, right?
Yeah. And what's it like today for you when you go through your day? What's the difference?
You know what? Okay, like today at work, I run a healthcare provider agency, and we're in the midst of internal survey and audit and all that. And I just inherited this disaster of a program. Good people, just poorly run for a long time. And busy, nonstop. I mean, overwhelming amounts of work and surveys and audits and so on. And I'm calm through all of it. I'm a pretty low-key person anyway, but I can do it. And recognize that it isn't all going to get done today, and we can only do what we can do. I live without fear, honestly, because there's always the pit in your stomach and the dread. Am I going to get caught this or that, or can I drink today? You know, I'm thinking about alcohol and not my job or my family or whatever. I mean, all that noise in your head that revolves around alcohol and its ramifications is gone. So days are busy, days are hard sometimes, that's fine, but it doesn't bring me down. It's, you can cope, like actually handle it, cope, not just tune it out. Because I think that alcohol for me, aside from the physical addiction end of things, was escapism, complete escapism from as soon as you get the drink and you don't think about the test you have to take, that kind of thing. You know, it's easy to just scrub the parts of your life that you don't want to deal with. So again, that Benjamin Hardy program helped a lot with that. It's just really good and pragmatic. And so for someone who's sort of coming out of the other end, it helps you open your eyes to what you really can do and what you or maybe people around you in some cases have been telling you you can't do, or limits you've imposed upon yourself that are kind of foolish. You know, like if you really just dare to see the bigger picture a little bit and focus, that you can do all kinds of things. So yeah, that's my day now. I wake up and I'm, you know, annoyed that it's cold out and I have to go to work, but I'm not afraid of what I did yesterday or what I'm going to do today or who I'm going to upset or who knows what.
So like a lot of people have hard time changing habits or like still using alcohol as a coping tool, which are two things you really just covered right now. So how did you deal with that? Was like the Benjamin Hardy program a big thing for you because it helped you to kind of vision your future self? Or what practical things did you do to shift the habits and coping and escapism and all of that?
Well, I tell you, kind of a lot of it sort of came prepackaged for me, because not only the Benjamin Hardy thing, but, and anyone watching, you can certainly pipe them to me. I can send them a link to it. Happy to do it. And no, I'm not a paid shill. It just really helped me when I needed some direction and a little bit of hope and structure to sort out what was going on. It helped. But what was the question again?
just the changing of habits and coping, practically. Habits.
Okay. So yes, that was a big part of it. So I moved. So this all happened in, my binge was in early October. I didn't drink through most of October after that. And then late October through the middle of November is when I did my little clinical step down process, weaning. During that time, I was alone in the house in Montana and we were moving. So I had to pack up, sell, give away a 3,200 square foot house full of stuff. So by myself, and organize it and put it on the market. I mean, my ex and I, of course, did that together and all that, but I had to do all of that and basically close up the house. And then I want to say December 24th, I landed out here. By landed, I mean showed up in a Ryder truck, divided into two halves, my stuff, her stuff, to go to two different apartments. So that was my repurposing and my restructure, which at the time, you know, especially early in that process, was pretty horrendous. Like I was quite literally walking around the house, reminding myself out loud that this is the hardest thing I'll ever have to do. And it was so far. But through that, I packed up the house. I got out here, got, you know, reunited with my kiddo. He and his mom are fine, but he's been daddy's boy since day one. You know, he's my guy. And then I moved out here and worked on, you know, getting a job and my licensure out here and so on and so forth. So I kind of came packaged or prepackaged therapy. And that was a ton of work. It was the hardest thing I ever had to do. That was a very lonely house, yeah. You know, but I will say the hardy thing kept me going there because you had purpose. Every day I would do this thing and it gets a little better when you sort out another aspect or whatever. No. So that's what I did. And then springtime in Minneapolis happened and it's lovely here. And I ended up going back to the brand of healthcare that I used to do and sucks you back in. And here I am, but I love it. So
that's great.
I'll tell you what I do. So yeah. Hopefully that answers the question.
Yeah, no, it does. And I find, like, in my own experience, my just outlook on the world changed so much after TSM. Like, when you're addicted to alcohol versus not, it's just like your whole perspective shifts. And it sounds like you probably got that too with the Hardy program. How has your perspective shifted, like, your just outlook on life and things now versus before TSM? Well,
I think I've grown up a lot. You know, there's, of course, lots of discussion around that where alcohol being in that state just sort of stunts your development, your emotional whatever development. It makes sense. I'm more tolerant. I was never a mean drunk. Like I didn't get fights or anything like that, but I could be sullen, you know, certainly towards the end. But I'm more tolerant. I work harder and a lot of this is ongoing process. But seeing things from other perspectives, you know, many years ago, I was in a few positions of leadership in my field and I didn't do very well at it. Looking back, it's pretty easy to see why I was absorbed in myself and booze. Now I'm doing very well in a program that no one's been able to fix. And it's because of that, a change in perspective. And I'm calm. I don't get excited about much at work, you know. Everyone's hair is on fire. I'm like, calm down. The sun will rise tomorrow, so let's just figure it out. And so I've become far more accepting and open to other ideas and, again, pragmatic because that's just kind of how I am.
Yeah. That's awesome.
Peaceful. Serenity. They say it a lot there, but that is a valid thing that we're all at. Wake up in the morning okay, go to bed at night okay.
Yeah, and so much easier to do when you're not battling alcohol
slow
cravings.
Down on me.
Oh, is it frozen? Okay. Are you there? Oh, there it goes.
It froze and then unfroze.
Let's see. I think it's working again.
I can hear you.
Okay. Oh,
you stopped again.
Lovely technology.
side note, my ex, her situation was very different, in that she became kind of she's not a housewife by any means. She's a pretty driven career person, but you know, Chardonnay after work. I mean, pick your cliche, or that just sort of grew into a bottle and a half at night, but absolutely functional and successful in her career. But she started this same time I did, and hers was far more gradual, more typical result. I mean, she slowed down, but then has, you know, of course, sped up at times with drinking and so on. But just a number of months ago, she claimed her extinction, and she now, as far as I know, we still talk and see each other, but drinks, you know, a third of what she used to and is happy with where she is. So she had a far more typical scenario over 9 months or so that occurred with her. Year, maybe.
It just speaks to like why it's so important not to compare our journeys, because sometimes people can feel discouraged. Like they look at your story and they're like, what? That's not fair. I want that myself.
On the Facebook boards, I have a few, and you know, I've never got heat from anyone for it. but I, you know, and everyone on the groups and Hank, every year, it's different for everybody. All you have to do is stay the course. One thing I will say that is discussed there a lot, for anyone watching this that's new, is the pill really is kind of a magic pill. However, it really only is half the story. That is true. Track your drinks. Be mindful. Think about what you're doing. You can do, if you're having trouble slowing down as much as you want, you know, wait to drink after dinner, switch drinks, all those, you know, talk to people about that. There's, you know, you have a new message board going up on C3, right? Or there, Facebook, wherever, find people that, you know, you can bounce ideas off. But it does half the work, and it makes your work a hell of a lot easier, but you need to do that work. Be that getting out and exercising, doing whatever, doing something that feels good. Gardening, sex, doesn't matter. But it takes intentionality. And I kind of hate that as a buzzword, but that's the best descriptor I can think of. You do need to be intentional about it and recognize what it's doing to help you so that you can leverage that and get better. And if you stick with it, do not break the holy cardinal rule, you'll get there.
Yeah, I totally agree. Yeah, it's tricky when we're only relying on the medication. Like you said, it's miracle, magical, but we need to change lifestyle, habits, coping tools, all of those things. And it's a process. For some people, it can happen more quickly, but in most cases I see it's like, give it a year. That's why I always try to tell people, like, just so they have a realistic expectation. If it happens sooner, that's like a pleasant surprise, but yeah.
Yeah. If you're paying attention and doing what you should be and being intentional about the whole thing, in a year, you, even if you aren't there yet, you're going to be able to look back and see how you're different and headed the right way. And some people, it takes a few years. That's fine. If you didn't do it, you'd still be drinking 2 years anyway. So why not keep after it? But that, I think, with my two failings along the way in 2020 was that I expected the pill to do the work. It just sort of blew it off. Like, woohoo, I have my solution. And that's not a good way to look at it.
No.
You got to try.
I wanted to ask, how's your relationship with your son different now compared to what it was before?
You know, he's such a, he just rolls with the punches with anything, but I know, I've talked to him about it, and I know he's happier. He's not afraid for me anymore. I don't think he was ever mad or thinking I was trying to hurt him, you know, not physically, but just in general. You know, he and I have always been very close, but I know that we're more solid than we ever have been. And he recognizes that I was ill and not, you know, I would never do anything to hurt him or anyone else. But I don't know, that's a hard one to answer because he's so laid back. But
yeah,
we're good. And he's happy. He's like, I'm glad that you fixed this.
So that's awesome.
Yeah.
I'm curious if you can describe like what being sober or abstinent, whatever you want to call it, now is like compared to what it's like, you know, if you've gone through AA or rehab, you know, just comparing the two.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Now I don't feel like I'm missing out on anything. I'm not resentful that I don't drink. being abstinent, and I had a 3-year stretch. What was I? 35-ish, maybe. 3-year stretch and a 1-year stretch with a lot of little brief interludes in between. And I never was particularly settled with that. I knew I was faking it. I knew that, you know, I don't believe the stuff coming out of their mouths, and I hate sitting in a meeting where the intention is to get through alcohol, but all you do is sit around and talk about alcohol and how you'll never really be over it. That was my thing. Like, God, all you do is bitch about alcohol. I want to get better. And I knew that when I was in those meetings. I'm like, I don't want to sit around a room in a church basement and talk about booze 3 nights a week. I want it to be behind me. And that doesn't mean not own what you did and, you know, fixing, you know, like the amends and all that. There's no formalized process in my life, but, you know, you need to own your stuff. I mean, that's part of getting better, is owning what you did, and but also recognizing why you did it. But so now I don't have that. I don't miss it. I don't feel like I'm missing out. It's very much like I've been there, done that, not interested anymore kind of thing. And I may drink someday. I mean, if I ever go to Ireland, I'm going to have a Guinness just because.
Because it's Ireland, and that's what you do.
It's Ireland, and you have to do it, right. But I wouldn't do it without a pill, which means that I won't really enjoy it all that much. So I might just blow it off anyway.
I think they make good non-alcoholic Guinness now. So I've heard. I think they make a good non-alcoholic Guinness.
Oh, do they say? I would totally try that.
Yeah.
I have a woman I've been dating, and I was at a pool party at her mother's house this summer, and someone there, I need to find out who, brought a non-alcoholic hoppy IPA type beer that I swear to God was good. I couldn't believe it. I'm like, oh my God, I gotta get this stuff, because most of the time I wouldn't want it, but after raking the yard in the summer, it does taste good.
Yep. And they're making some good ones nowadays. Yeah. So good timing for reaching extinction. Good on you.
Right, yeah, totally. Now, see, the funny thing is that I don't know if I'll ever bother, you know, kind of like the lottery. I think, it'd be nice to win the lottery, but I'd never buy a ticket. I don't bother. It might be nice to have a beer, but then I'm like, I don't feel like it.
I love that analogy.
Yeah. So I'm just looking over. My keys are sitting on the counter and I have the pills in there. I probably should trade them out. They're all covered in aluminum dust now. But I have the knowledge that maybe that's part of it. I have the knowledge that I can, which takes the pressure off of not. Maybe. But I just don't want to. I've had the fleeting thought a few times, and I've never even come close to taking a pill with the intention.
Wow. And I know people don't love that it's called a cure, because it's like, well, you have to take the pill, but it does feel like you're cured.
Right. Yeah. So, I mean, can I drink without taking the pill? No, or yes, a lot. But for me, I am, because I have the pill as a security measure, but I don't ever want to. It's not like I'm on a medication to live my daily life. I haven't ingested it. Literally sometime within a week exactly of a year. So I feel cured, and I don't care what they say. Yeah. The big book also says somewhere in there, in the big book, I don't remember where, it says maybe science someday will create a pill that cures us. But until then, we have this, you know, from 1937 or two or whatever it is. Well, the pill is here. Yeah, you suggest this to someone who is in AA, and like I said, it's madness. I'm like, it's really not. It's science.
I honestly made a video a couple of weeks ago it's in chapter 3 of the book, and I highlighted it saying, well, there is a cure now. And oh man, I've gotten so much hate from AA people. Like, you don't change the big book. This is like the Bible. And I'm like, but it's inaccurate.
Yeah, it's wrong. Or they predicted correctly. We'll get it that way. He said, maybe someday there will be a pill. Well, naltrexone's not exactly new. It's been around for ages. We just use it wrong. I say that to people all the time in my field, physicians. So you use it wrong. On proof, if you'll open up your ears and listen for a little while and consider what I say to you, you might understand. I turned my provider around in Montana.
She one doctor like, at a time.
Yeah, she prescribed it for me. She says, I'm going to write it the normal way, but you do what you do. I know you will anyway. And here I am. I actually need to call her, tell her it's been a year and I couldn't possibly be happier. Because I was the first person to ever mention it to her. She's an NP in Missoula. And I don't know if she ever watched the video. I told her to watch the movie. I said, it's only an hour and it's even kind of entertaining. It's not dry. Watch it and tell me that there isn't something to this. But since that time that I told her about it and I moved away from Montana, five more people came to her asking about it. I think that had anything to do with me, but I told her for every one of those people, if they ever wanted to talk to someone, just give them my name. I'm not shy, you know, I'm happy to tell somebody that's struggling about this. So there you go.
It's so cool.
It is way cool. It is beyond cool.
It's like
I've been given a second chance that I never thought I would have ever. 35 years of fighting this with no weapon at all. And all it took was that.
Yeah. That's pretty amazing. And, you know, it took that, but it also took, I think, your being ready to change and also you being consistent in seeking out the other things that were helping you develop and focus on the future.
Yeah.
And
oh, yeah. Diving in and doing a little, you know, doing some work on yourself along the way and being invested. And, you know, we don't have meetings, but actually Hank lives here.
No way.
In Memphis somewhere. Yeah, I need to hook up with him. We need to go out to dinner or something.
I would love to meet him in person.
Yeah, totally would. But, you know, and I would tell anyone, you know, get on the Facebook groups or your group there. I mean, it doesn't matter. Just find some like-minded people who won't beat you up if you mess up and recognize that for a lot of us, it's just part of the process. You know, take a little bit of solidarity with other people because we've all been there. That is an aspect of AA I like. It's just that they all get together to talk about how bad it is and relive all the bad versus moving forward. Not all, that's not fair, but a lot. Yeah. So yeah, it's doable.
Do you feel like you're in recovery or do you feel recovered?
I feel recovered. It's not a daily thing. It's a not wake up and pray or what, you know, I mean, praying to me feels weird because I'm just talking to myself in a room. You know, I don't believe in any of that. So, but you know, AA, it's like a constant reminder. It's like you have to adopt this whole new thing into your life focused around the thing that you want out of your life. And for some folks, it has worked. My ex, her father is 45 years or something, goes to one meeting every Monday since forever. He's one of the old timer fart guys, but he's a perfectly nice man. It has worked for him. I mean, he gives up an hour every Monday night and he does his best to help kids that are coming in struggling. I can't fault him for that, you know. But the vast majority, I don't know if we even have numbers yet, but 5 to 7% long haul. So he, my brother, I mean, they're the fortunate few because most just come and go. And if they're there because they have a nudge from the judge, their odds are about zero because they won't be there in the first place. Yeah, I feel recovered. I mean, I'm mindful. I know, you know, it'll always be there, but it's not something I have to consider but once in a blue moon.
Yeah.
And the answer is easy. You forget I actually drink, take the pill. And then I'm like, no, because that's not fun. So what do I care?
Yeah.
That's the process and it's gone in a minute. And that only happens every couple months.
And take it from me, it gets less and less the longer you're going alcohol free. It just becomes
right. Yeah. I mean, it's just sort of out of my life. And so my girlfriend have a beer now and then. I don't care. Even if you kiss her and you taste it, it doesn't matter. How long have you been sober or whatever we call it?
Yeah, it's been over 3 years now, like almost three. Yeah, 3 years and a few months or something.
Yeah. So funny you don't think of a birthday or whatever. Yeah. It's like, oh yeah, that's why I said, I'm like, hey, I think it's been about a year. Cool. But it's not like I was counting down to that point. It just happened.
Not the days, not 900 or
yeah. 3 years. That's
Yeah, I don't even remember my last drink. It was accidental. I just kept going longer and longer without drinking, and I was like, well, I guess I'm not going to drink again. But I still have naltrexone too.
Yeah, just carry it around
Yeah.
in your little keychain.
Exactly.
Yeah, well, that's cool.
Yeah.
3 years is a long time, and but really it isn't, because you'll go the rest of your life and not drink and
Yeah.
not care one bit. And that's the beauty of it. You're free of the grip, not just of, beating yourself up with it, but the grip of the anxiety that surrounds the thought of not drinking anymore. Because
Yes.
you wake up in the morning and you don't worry about the fact that you aren't going to drink today, because you just don't drink and you don't care.
Yeah, my brain's been fixed. It's a miracle. Same to you.
I, brain's been fixed. That's exactly it. And it is possible. And I wish the AAs of the world would, I don't understand why they're like that. I mean, there isn't even that much money generated in AA, and it's not like someone's making a ton of money. So what on earth is the resistance? I don't get it.
Yeah, like you said, it's like this belief system people have to tote around and make their identity. And then when people that works for them, it's like they're so hard pressed. They're like, there's no other way because this is the way that worked for me. And
Because, for 20 years ago, that kind of was the deal, and no one knew any better. And yeah, they carry around this identity that I don't want the identity of a drinker or not a drinker. I just want my own identity.
yeah, me too.
That's
Well, so as we wrap up, I'm just curious, is there anything else you want to share that you haven't had a chance to, or tips or insights or advice or reflections?
I guess I would, in looking on, the message boards or whatever, I would just remind people that there is no one perfect way, that this doesn't happen the same for everyone. And I know this is said often, but my circumstance was an unusual one. And I'm grateful for it. Took me putting myself in the hospital and ending up divorced and all that, but it's not like it didn't come with a cost, but the effect on me, chemically speaking, was unusual. I recognize that. But my kid's looking at me, he says, "When are we gonna eat?" Advice is stick with it and be invested. You won't spend the rest of your life every day thinking about it, but for a while you need to be a bit intentional and find some other purpose, I think, to marry with the process. Fill it with something. That doesn't mean you have to become a marathon runner or whatever, but work towards something. Mine was I did the Benjamin Hardy thing and have since moved on with other stuff, but it really helped me develop a little structure and purpose, because there is a void to fill. And so filling it with something that you believe in is pretty important, I think. It's the other half to the equation.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, Mac, it's been a real pleasure to have you on. Thank you so much for taking time to share your story with us.
Of course.
I know it'll reach a lot of people out there. So thanks again.